H.H. Gregg is coming back. This counter is from the homepage of their website as of Monday, October 16th. It appears to be counting down to October 23rd. So if you're watching this anytime after that date, H.H. Gregg is already back. It's not one of the largest or most well-known companies. If you live outside of the United States, odds are you've never heard of it. If you live in the United States, there's still a good chance you've never heard of it. As of 2016, it had 226 locations throughout 20 states. I ran some quick figures, and it turns out that's not even half the states. I guess we can say it's an East Coast thing. Basically, all of those 226 locations are located in the eastern half of the country. So for all of the non-US residents, as well as over half the US residents, let me tell you about this store. It's a lot like Best Buy. Alright, now that we have an idea of what we're talking about, let's go back to 1955. That's the year the company began. It was in Indiana by a man named Henry Harold Gregg. I'm honestly not sure if any of the letters in H.H. Gregg should be capitalized or not. My instinct says yes, but officially it seems to have no capital letters or periods, nor does it have any in the logo. So for the purposes of this video, I opted to keep it all lowercase. H.H. Gregg functioned as a single location for 14 years. In 1969, the second location opened, and it wasn't until 1987 when they finally opened a location outside of Indiana. Now I want to skip to 2007, because that's where things really started happening with this company. After 52 years, the company became publicly owned. At this time, they were up to 77 locations, mostly in Ohio, Indiana, and Georgia. From here, they just kept growing. And by 2013, they had increased those 77 locations to 228 locations, nearly tripling in size. So just stop to think about that for a second. It took the company 14 years to open its second store, a rate of one every 14 years. 38 years to open another 75 stores, a rate of about two per year. And then it took only 6 years to open 151 locations, a rate of 25 per year. For any company in any industry, this is an incredible growth rate. But 2013 marked the end of it. From 2013 to 2016, their number of locations were practically stagnant. Here's a graph that reflects that. Now, I'm going to add one more year to the graph. See, that's right. In 2017, it was all over. In March of this year, they filed Chapter 11 bankruptcy. The reorganization, debt protection, bankruptcy, the kind where the company continues to exist.
Indianapolis-based appliance and furniture company H.H. Gregg is filing for bankruptcy. Executives say it's not going out of business. It's merely reorganizing.
But 1 month later, April of this year, the company was just done. Here's a quote from the CEO. While we had discussions with more than 50 private equity firms, strategic buyers, and other investors, unfortunately, we were unsuccessful in our plan to secure a viable buyer of the business on a going concern basis within the expedited timeline set by our creditors. Simply put, they couldn't find anyone that wanted to buy the company that would keep it in business and comply with the creditors. And just like that, after 62 years, H.H. Gregg was done. So the question I'm sure we all want answered is, what the heck happened? 52 years of smooth sailing, followed by a period of tremendous expansion, and then all of a sudden 3 years of nothingness and the complete shutdown of the company. My answer to this comes in two parts. The first part is the bigger of the two, meaning I would point to it as the core reason. And that reason is expansion. Aggressive expansion. Possibly even reckless or destructive expansion. If I could summarize H.H. Gregg's main objective over the past 10 years in one word, yeah, you guessed it, expansion. Here's the front page of their 2008 annual report. Execution, growth, longevity. I can confidently say they achieved two of those three things. Here's page 5 from that same report. We remain committed to disciplined growth of H.H. Gregg in the future, and we continue to believe there is room to expand H.H. Gregg's footprint across the United States to more than 400 stores over the long term. This is an article from the Wall Street Journal from 2010. They have a plan to expand to 600 stores in this decade. And then a little later in the same article, some retail experts worry that H.H. Gregg's pace poses a risk of overexpansion. Well, I think they were right about this one. I understand a business's desire to grow, but my goodness. But I do understand how they developed this mindset. Around 2007 to 2009, they had some attractive opportunities placed in front of them. First of all, it was right around this time when the economy tanked, and they were able to purchase new locations at low prices. Now, you could say it was foolish for an electronics store to expand during an economic downturn, but they seemed to make it through it, and honestly, the economy at that time would be pretty low on my list of reasons for their failure. So, for one, they were able to expand at a low price. And for two, has anyone heard of another electronics store called Circuit City? Well, I'll save the details of that one for a future video. But they were closing stores and going out of business right around this time period. So not only did Circuit City leave an opening in the industry that H.H. Gregg could potentially fill, they also left a lot of potential locations for new H.H. Gregg stores. Imagine you're an up-and-coming electronics store, and all of a sudden there's a huge opening in the industry and a bunch of perfect store locations for sale at a low price. You can't blame them for wanting to take advantage of this. I mean, with these circumstances, it almost looked like God himself was trying to tell them to go open more stores. But let me tell you the issue with this. You're playing a game of Monopoly, and you're trying to decide whether or not you should purchase some houses. If you're a safe player, you'd probably purchase a few, but be sure to keep some money just in case you land on someone else. If you're a risky player, you'd probably spend all your money on houses and hope someone lands on you before you land on them. Well, guess which type of player H.H. Gregg was. They were out buying houses as soon as they got their 200 for pass and go. And when they finally landed on someone else, they had no money to pay. They were forced to sell their houses at a loss just to stay alive. Okay, the Monopoly metaphor's over. For now. But that's what they did. They expanded to a point where all their money was tied up in property and inventory. And I mean it when I say they had no money. On their balance sheet for 2016, they had $385 million in total assets, which is good. But $256 million of it was tied up in inventory, and $87 million of it is in property and equipment. Of the $385 million in total assets, only $3.7 million of it was in cash. So just like the Monopoly player, they would have to sell some stuff in order to generate some money. And of course the company wasn't that risky of a Monopoly player, they left some money to work with. And this brings me to my second reason for their failure. Decreased sales and negative profits. Here's a graph of their sales over the years. It looks like what we would expect. Increasing up until 2012, 2013, then decreasing through 2016. But this graph is misleading. Because remember their aggressive expansion from 07 to 2013? The only reason we see an increase in this graph is because their number of store locations were also increasing. So more stores, more sales. The more meaningful graph to look at would be their sales per store. And when I bring up that graph, it looks like their troubles began all the way back in 2009 and just became more severe starting in 2013. When I bring up the income graph, it tells the same story. When the negative income hit in 2015, they needed cash to cover it, and they had it. They started the year with $48 million and ended it with $30 million. And in 2016, they started with $30 million and they ended with $3.7 million, that we saw before. I think we need a quick recap here. H.H. Gregg expanded to a point where they had limited cash available. 2 years of poor sales and negative income drained that limited cash to nearly zero. they got to a point where they couldn't sustain any more losses without selling assets in a big way. And as you know, when you get to that point in Monopoly, things are just about over. If a company has a couple of years of poor sales or negative income, they should be able to survive. If they have a strong foundation and everything's in order, it should be nothing more than a little rough patch. But since H.H. Gregg left themselves so unstable from their aggressive expansion, it only took a few years of poor sales to completely wipe them out. But the question still remains, why did their sales take such a hit? Of course, things like Amazon and online sales are likely a part of it. I've seen things saying they failed to adapt to e-commerce in the way that they should have, but I think a big part of the problem was Best Buy. I don't think I'm out of line saying that Best Buy is the largest and most well-known store of this nature in the United States. Even if you hate Best Buy, you at least know who they are. H.H. Gregg was known in Indiana and Ohio and a few other states, but for the people in Florida, Virginia, Wisconsin, Louisiana, Missouri, and many other states, H.H. Gregg had no reputation or familiarity that they could use to draw customers. And without that, they need to have something that separates themselves from Best Buy. H.H. Gregg says they differentiate themselves from their competitors by providing their customers with a consultative and educational purchase experience, combined with superior delivery and installation capabilities on many of their products. And really, I'm not seeing anything in that sentence that really separates them from Best Buy. Aside from that, there's two small things I suppose could separate them. One is that the salespeople at H.H. Gregg actually have the authority to bargain with the customers on the prices, which I could see as being a positive. The other is that H.H. Gregg puts more of an emphasis on appliances than Best Buy does. It's actually about half their business, so I suppose if I knew that, I would go to H.H. Gregg for an appliance before I go to Best Buy. This is about all I can find that may entice a person to go there over Best Buy, but it isn't much. I don't even like Best Buy, but in most cases I would probably go there before H.H. Gregg. It just doesn't appear that they've done enough to compete with Best Buy in these new markets, so it would make sense that their newer locations would have trouble selling stuff. And as for H.H. Gregg today, the name, the logo, and some other stuff were purchased for $400,000, and this is what they've done with it. It's going to be online only, but they teased that there may be some actual locations in the future. I don't have high hopes for them, but we'll have to see how their grand opening sale goes and where they progress from there. Let me know in the comments what you see for the future of H.H. Gregg. Are they as good as done, or do you think they have the potential to become something significant once again? And let me know if you agree with my theories about their decline, or if you have any other theories you'd like to contribute. I'd like to hear what you have to say. Thank you for watching.